on the 70 weeks of Daniel on Sunday morning, one series. That was one series. I did about five other series. I can't believe people don't teach the Old Testament. They don't understand what it's about. They don't know it. That's why they don't teach it. Without understanding Old Testament, you cannot understand the New. It's not possible. Well, we're just living in crazy times.
Go ahead.
Are we ready?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. All right. It's Wednesday night, and we are studying. Gosh, we're studying so many things. We're studying predestination, what we're predestined to. Predestination is about accountability and responsibility, because we are predestined. Predestination is not wishing. People say, whom he did foreknow, he also did wish that they would conform to the image of his son. That's not wishing. He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image, to the icon, to the likeness of Jesus. That's what predestination is about. And we're not like him, because there's none good, not one. There's none understands. There's none that seeketh after God. Nobody seeks God until Christ comes into a man's heart, births himself by his will into his heart, and then he starts. He has to put truth in his heart. God has to put faith in his heart. Now, we've been talking about faith. You know, when I was a young preacher, I had no idea what faith was. Have you ever asked yourself, what is faith? I used to ask myself that. I didn't know what it was. This was before I started studying in-depth Greek. Well, I found out what it is. And we've been talking about it, what faith is and what it does. What it does and how it saves. And when it saves, now remember, saved is the word sozo. Sozo. And every time it's pronounced S-O-D-Z-O, the Z in the Greek language is pronounced D-Z. Okay? So S-O, if you ever hear somebody say sozo, sozo, that means they don't know anything about Greek, because they wouldn't be pronouncing it that way. And the Bible says many times, thy faith has made thee whole. Every charismatic Pentecostal will say, that means they were healed. No, that means they weren't healed. Because sozo, every time it's used, thy faith has made thee whole, it's the word saved. Faith saves. It doesn't heal anybody. I don't know what in the world these people think that are charismatics. The big charismatic people have been dying here in the last few years. Oral Roberts died of heart disease. Kenneth Hagin died of pneumonia. And Jan Krauts died because she got too old and too mean, or something like that. And when she died, everybody started making an excuse for her, and even Joel Osteen said, well, she just kind of lost her faith. It got weak on her. She was 78, you knucklehead. It was time for her to die, and she was cheating too many people and lying to them. And they all started making excuses. Did any of you hear them make excuse for her dying? Like, she just lost her faith. And I thought, you people are ignorant. When you get 78, 88, it's time to die for a whole lot of people that are out there stressing out, cheating the world. It's time to die. It's appointed unto man once to die. That word appointed means it's a set time. Now, faith does not heal. If it did, I'm going to say this again. If faith healed, no one would have to die of old age. When you get to old age, I've asked several doctors. I need to ask my other doctors that I haven't asked. I'm just going to want to say, hey, when a person dies of old age, what do they die of? Every time you ask a doctor that, they'll say, well, they die of pulmonary disease, or they die of cardiac disease, heart disease. Why are you asking that? I just wanted an official word from an authority how people die of old age. There's no medical book that you open it up and it says, old age, you die when you get to a certain point in your life of old age. That's not in a medical book. You die of disease. And proof of that is wrinkles, gray hair. If you could be healed, your hair would stop. If nothing else, it would stop getting any grayer. And you'd get no more wrinkles. That is funny to me that you don't even have to go to the Bible to understand that. Everybody is dying. As soon as you're born, you start dying, don't you? Being in this flesh. We're talking about what is faith and what does it do. I'm going to use some verses, and this goes along with what I've been teaching, and we'll go back to this from time to time. Israel in the wilderness. And they had something that was in common with us when it comes to this dying thing that I was talking about. They were out here in the wilderness. Here's the Mediterranean Sea, and this is Egypt down here. And then you get over here to Libya, and then you're going over here to Carthage area, and you get to this point where the Spain comes down and nearly touches the African continent at that rock of Gibraltar, the Strait of Gibraltar. Well, Israel is here, and Egypt is down here, and everything that we're talking about is about this. Now, they were coming out of Egypt, came to this Sinai Peninsula, and here's what they've got in common with us. That is, that entire book of Numbers is their trek through the wilderness. They come down here to Sinai, and then they leave Sinai in Numbers, the 10th chapter, and they come up here to Kadesh Barnea. And if they had not have had a hard heart, God would have taken them into the land, but He had a plan for them to harden their heart. He had their hearts hardened. So they'll wander through the wilderness because they had so much unbelieving people out here. Unbelief in the Greek would be apistis, and pistis would be the word, actually the word faith, would be the word faith, and in the Greek you have a noun and a verb form of the noun. The verb form is pisteuo, pistuo, and the noun form is pistis. Notice that pist, that's called the stem of the word. And the word endings are changed. God changed them. I didn't change them. The word endings are changed depending on what the word is. So when God inspired the word faith, He would inspire pistis. When He would inspire the verb form, it was believed. So it's important that you know when the Bible says, when Paul and Silas were in a Philippian jail over in Philippi, this is where they were. There's an exact place you can go to find out where they were. This is the Aegean Sea here. Here's Greece. There's Corinth. This is what they call a Peloponnesus. It looks like a little hand, like a thumb there. And Corinth was in here. And this is Asia, what they called Asia. The seven churches are right here on the western end of Turkey. This little state here is Galatia. Here's Cappadocia up here, Bithynia up here. And when you're reading the book of Acts, you're going to read about those places. Now, I was talking about something I forgot. Oh, I was talking about faith. And apistis, A-P-I-S-T-I-S, when you find the word unbelief in the New Testament, you look it up in a concordance, it is the word no faith. The alpha privative negates the word. So unbelief is the word apistis. The Bible says that these people that weren't believers, that kept murmuring against Moses and God and Aaron, says over there in Hebrews 3 and 4, they could not enter into the promised land because of unbelief. And this is what they have in common with us. We've got unbelief in our lives. And that unbelief has to be converted by God to belief. It's the outer man that doesn't believe God. It's unbelief. In fact, let me just read those verses. I'm trying to make this real plain. Over here in Hebrews, the third chapter, I'm going to read the last couple of verses of the chapter. I've read it, and it's talking about how Israel, in the wilderness, they rebelled against God. And here's what the Bible says. There was a certain number of them. It wasn't people becoming involved in unbelief. When they entered the wilderness, they were unbelieving when they entered. God had their minds fixed. And these that did not believe, they're going to go through the wilderness, and God's going to take 40 years in the wilderness to kill off all the unbelievers. All the unbelief. That's why when you get to Deuteronomy comes from duo and nomos. A duo is two people. This means second law. So Deuteronomy is repeating a lot of things that was said in Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. So this is right before, this is after 40 years, right at the end of 40 years, they've gone through the wilderness. This is a picture of our lives. The 40 years is our lives in the wilderness, our lives in this world. And God takes 40 years. I could go into four judgments to kill off four, and every multiple of 10, 100, 1,000 is a form of this original number. The four judgments of the sword, the famine, the pestilence, and the beast. And after all these judgments in our lives, God's going to kill off all unbelief. And he said, these unbelievers in the wilderness, look here, in Hebrews. In Hebrews, the third chapter, verse 17. But with whom was God grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? He's killing them off. And to whom swear he that they would not enter into his rest or into Canaan, but to them that believe not? So we see that they could not enter in because of apistis. No faith. These are Jews that went into the wilderness, and God's going to take that 40 years to kill off unbelief. And by the time they get to the Canaan, and they haven't crossed the river yet, here's the Sea of Galilee, here's the Dead Sea, and this is the Jordan River. By the time they get up, well, they cross just above the Dead Sea. By the time they get here to the river to cross and repossess the land that was given to Abraham hundreds of years before, by the time they get there, all unbelief is gone out of Israel. That's why you can look at certain verses in Deuteronomy. Choose you this day whom you will serve. Well, he couldn't be talking about choose God to accept Christ as your Savior because they're all believers. And when he says choose you this day, he says choose either the gods on the other side of the flood, which were evil gods, or choose the gods of the land where you're going. He didn't give them a choice between good and evil. He gave them a choice between evil and evil. And then he said, as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. Over there in the 30th chapter of Deuteronomy, he says, choose life. He's not telling them, choose to be saved and follow me. He's saying, select living in righteousness. It's the same thing I'll say to a congregation here. I'll say, live righteously for the Lord. That's the only reward that you can have in this life as a believer. He wasn't saying, choose whether you want to serve God or go to hell. And people look at those verses in Deuteronomy like that's what he's saying. When Joshua said, choose you this day whom you'll serve, Joshua was leading them across, and they were believers. Even in the second chapter of Judges, it says, when a generation of Israel grew up that knew not the Lord, then they went back to Baal and the grove. Those people that came in knew the Lord. So when you're reading in Deuteronomy, or you're reading in Joshua, and it sounds like a choice of good and evil, it never is. Now, so here's how this ties in the wilderness. They had unbelievers there, and we got an unbeliever in our life, and that's self. Now, you start off with Christ in you, which he was birthed there by the will of God. What does a man have that is not born again? He has no inner man. He has nothing but himself. And if God doesn't birth him, he's going to hell. He's a vessel of wrath fitted to destruction. Those of us that believe God, that we've been born again, and we'll know that. A fellow asked me the other day, how do we know we're elect? I said, we're elected to obedience. And we've got nothing but disobedience in us. When we first come to the knowledge of Christ, we're tempted by drinking, by sex, by gambling, by living in sin. And this inner man has to very gradually take over. And those little circles that I'm putting around there, that is fire and trials. And God will put you through everything. He'll beat you. He'll scourge you. And what he's doing is causing your faith, the inner man, faith is death to self. And gradually self dissipates through the years. Each one of those circles there can be a trial, a tribulation, a persecution. There's two sufferings in the Bible, especially the New Testament, well, in the Old Testament too. There's two sufferings. The first one comes from God. He puts us through fire and trials and persecution. And there is men that cause us to suffer, and they are working in the hands of God. Some of the suffering that we go through is not necessarily, well, for those of us that go through it, that are believers, all of our sufferings are to cause us to have great faith. If this little circle here, this outer circle, when you get old, you've been out there a long time in the world, you got a thin veneer of self. But you don't have all this that God has caused you to give up through the years. And this is called increasing faith. Now, everything that faith is has to increase in our life. It must increase. You can't just live with a little faith. The Bible keeps telling, the Lord keeps telling the apostles, O ye of little faith. And he said that to him while there were a bunch of young boys following him around, and God had convicted in their heart to be the apostles. I keep saying it. When you see a picture of Jesus at 30 years old starting his ministry, don't think that that the apostles following him around are a bunch of old men that they paint in these pictures. They couldn't be. They had little faith. They were young guys. We know that John the Beloved, when Jesus is 30 years old, John had to be very young. Those guys were probably in their early 20s. That's the way I'm guessing. Or very late teens. Because John is going to be writing the book of Revelation in 96 A.D. It's believed that's when it was written. Well, how in the world is he going to live 66 years if he's already 65 back here? He wouldn't be, would he? They were young. They were young kids. And they're growing as their faith grows. And he would tell Peter, "Oh, ye of little faith." Now, these men that there were unbelievers here, the Bible says here in Hebrews, so we see that they could not enter into the promised land because of unbelief. It was little faith or no faith. Apistis is the word, A-P-I-S-T-I-S. Apistis, no faith or little faith at the very best. Now, I've been talking about if faith is dead to self, it's working when it's dying. Faith is working when it's dying. It's actually working on the outer man, killing off the outer man, and it's because you're going through fire, trials, persecution, all this God brings into your life. And when you learn to give up self, frustration goes away. When you get old enough, frustration won't be there. I'm not frustrated. I know everything is the will of God. I know that. I had to take Mary to the emergency room yesterday. Blood pressure went out the roof. People say, "Well, you don't need to be worried." We don't have any worries. We don't have any bills. We love each other. We don't know why it happens. The doctor said today, we don't know why. It just goes up in some people. But we accept that as the will of God. And we're all going to die anyway, aren't we? Of some disease if we don't get killed in a car wreck or a tree don't fall on us, you know. Or a piano don't fall on us somewhere, like in one of them old movies. Now, we've been talking about faith working. When faith is working, death to self is working. If you go through enough trials, enough fire, you'll begin to give up on self, and then you begin to find out when God kills off self, the more he kills off self by all these fire and trials, the easier life is to live because you're not frustrated over things like you were when you were young. Now, we've been talking about faith works. Faith works by love. Let me show you something. I don't know how in the world to sell this to you because it's an awful lot. If you say faith works, first of all, let me give you a couple of verses. And you cannot fake faith. You can't fake it. You cannot fake. Faith works by love. Galatians 5, 6. Faith worketh by love. Now, if you don't know what love is, you don't know what faith is, you can read that when you're young, or read that when you're old in some Baptist church, you don't even know what it's talking about. You're just lost as a goose. Well, it sure does. Faith works by love. You know, I'm learning to go around liking everybody, and my faith is working when I like everybody. Well, that's not what it says. Love is that I keep saying it. You got two words in the scripture, agape and phileo, that are the words, have been translated to the word L-O-V-E. You cannot take our word love and translate it back into the Greek. It's not possible. And agape, of course, do you know that everybody uses that word in churches more than any other word? The Church of Christ got an organization called the Agape, and it's getting together with a bunch of Church of Christ and talking about how you have to be baptized in water by a Church of Christ preacher in order to go to heaven. That's what they call agape. And you'll hear somebody, oh yes, I know what agape is. That's a godly love. That's an awful simple explanation. I have researched this word. I've looked at it in the concordance. It doesn't have a real good definition in the concordance. Some people have resented Mr. Strong for having the definition that he's got in there. And he'll say an affection. Well, it is to a degree. Jesus said in John, the 15th chapter, you are my friends if you keep my commandments. Well, that word friend comes from the word phileo. It is the word philia. And it means to have affection for. Have affection. But this word agape, Jesus said, if you keep my commandments, that would be agape, because the Bible says in 2 John 6, this is agape. It says this is love in a King James Bible, but that word love is agape. This is love that we walk after His commandments. So, the definition of agape, you can fit right in here. If you walk in agape, then you're my friend. I'm real careful what I use when I use the word friend. I never say, I used to have a friend in real estate. I realize I can't say that anymore. I have to say I had an acquaintance in real estate. Because if they weren't walking in God's commandments, they were cussing and drinking and smoking, which a whole lot of them do. And if they don't do that, they go to the Church of Christ or go to the Baptist church, and they don't believe anything. So I can't call somebody a friend unless they're walking in the commandments of God, because I'm predestined to be like Jesus. And I have to keep the same things in mind. Does that mean I get to be mean to people that I used to know? No. I'm very kind to everybody. I'm gentle to them. But a friend is someone you have affection for and you want to go out and eat with, you want to go bowling with, you want to go to their house and eat steaks on Friday night. You call them and you bring them to your house and they let out a cuss word once in a while. And maybe they go to the big Baptist church or something. Well, we cannot. That gets into the subject of disfellowshipping with people who walk disorderly, doesn't it? So you have to stay away from them. I'll be as kind as I can to everybody in public. I'll talk to whoever wants to hear the truth. If they don't want to hear it, I say, okay. So, walking in the commandments of God is agape. So the Bible says, faith works by love. So you got to define faith in everything it is and everything it does. And it'll tell you all about how it works by walking the commandments. But you have to come up and find out what are the commandments of God. Well, this is where people get confused. Jesus said his commandments were, they're imperatives, actually. We have more than just the Ten Commandments over here. All of the law is still being fulfilled. You had a temple over here. this is part of the commandments of God. You had a temple. You had priests. You had kings. Well, you still have priests and kings. The Bible says, He hath made us, hath made his past tense. He hath made us priests and kings. How are we a priest? A priest offered acceptable sacrifice without blemish. As we give our bodies a living sacrifice, our faith, debt to self, increases, and Christ increases in us, and then that has to do with entering into the kingdom, and we have to grow and grow and grow. Now, they had a priest and king over here. We're priests and kings. We give our bodies a living sacrifice. God would not have told you that in Romans 12 and 1 if you weren't a priest. The only way we are a royal priesthood there in 1 Peter 2 and 9. We're a royal priesthood. We're king because the king lives in us and we pronounce righteous judgment, John 7, 24. Look not at the outward appearance, but judge righteous judgment. That's what a king does. We're already priests and kings. And we give our bodies not a sacrifice, but a living sacrifice. And we die daily because we're wanting to get rid of that outer man that is full of contention and strife and likes to argue at 30 years old and wants to have his way. I know I did. Did anybody else here want their way? I think everybody did. They had a house of God over here. Christ is the son of his own house. Whose house are we? And everything behind that veil was called the house of God. They had Ark of the Covenant where the law was written on tables of stone. And the Word of God and the Ark of the Covenant was sprinkled. We got our heart where the law was written on fleshy table of our hearts. And it's sprinkled. And we're the temple of God. And the candlesticks is the seven churches of Asia. Revelation 1:20. The altar of incense is the prayers of the saints. And the table of showbread. We being many are one bread and one body. We're washed in the blood of Christ instead of the brazen sea. And we give our bodies upon this brazen altar. So what we're going to have to come up with, everything over here is equal to everything over here. And we're trying to get rid of that dead man, and it takes faith increasing to do that. When their faith isn't growing, they're contrary believers. They're ornery. They like to find fault with everybody, especially the preacher. Look over here what Paul said about these people who are constantly finding fault with him. In 2 Corinthians... Look over here in 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. And Paul was correcting the Corinthians from one end of the first book to another. And they were upset at him because he called them children. He said, you need to be drinking milk and not eating the meat because you're sitting around arguing all the time. 1 Corinthians doesn't have one word of commendation in it. He's not commending them for anything to do it. He's correcting them through the whole book. Get over there to 2 Corinthians, and they're griping, they're complaining about everything he's saying. Let me read some things to you about what they said. If your faith does not grow, you're going to find fault in me and everybody around you. A lot of people have left here complaining and griping, and they were young. Some of them wasn't so young, they just wanted to be in charge. And so they start complaining about the preacher. That's the best place to start. You don't like what's going on, complain about the preacher, because people will do that. So Paul's telling you the same thing. They were doing the same thing at Corinth. Look at that 10th chapter of 2 Corinthians. All right. Now, let's kind of go up here a little ways in the chapter, and you'll see how angry they are at him. He's correcting up in the first part of the chapter that they need to be casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. They're saying, we know what the Bible means. We know more than the preacher knows. And Paul, you don't have to come preaching to us. Into captivity, every thought to the obedience of Christ. It's because they weren't obedient. And having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience, when your obedience is fulfilled, do you look on things after the outward appearance? He says, don't look at the outward appearance, look at the heart. The way he's telling Corinth, you're doing the same thing when Samuel looked Jesse looked at his oldest son, and Samuel looked at his oldest son and said, surely this Eliab is going to be the leader of Israel. And that's when God said, man looks at the outward appearance. The Lord looks at the heart. He said, it's none of these older sons, and it ended up being David, the youngest one. If any man trusts to himself that he is Christ, let him of himself think this again, that as he is Christ, even so are we Christ. It's like they were standing alone saying, well, we're the Christians around here. For though I should boast somewhat more of our authority, he's saying, I'm the preacher. I started the church there. I've got people coming in here want to take over. We think you got something wrong with you, Jim Brown. Nothing anymore that's wrong with you. And which the Lord hath given us for edification and not for your destruction. He said, I'm not trying to destroy you. People have come here thought I was trying to destroy them because I'd say, look, you can't talk like this. You can't live like that. If I'm not going to be the pastor here, who is? Had one fellow said, we're all pastors. We are. Where's your church? Where's your building? Where's your gathering? You don't have any business pastoring if you don't know what you're talking about. And not for your destruction, I should not be ashamed, that I may seem as if I would terrify you by letters. You think the way I'm writing, it's awful blunt. I told you there at Corinth in 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, I told you that you need to use great plainness of speech. Parhesia, and you don't like that at Corinth. P-A-R-R-H-E-S-I-A. When I am blunt to the point, I get blunt to the point with people, they think I'm mad because my voice is loud and sharp and I'm not angry. I'm just saying you can't do that here. And a lot of people will not be corrected in life. You know that, don't you? You're putting that in the wrong place. Well, I don't care what you say. I'm going to put these cans here because I work here at Publix and you can't tell me what to do. All right. The manager comes along and says, take those out of there and put them over where they belong. Some people will not be corrected, especially about sin in the church. And then he goes on to say, see, he's talking about them arguing with him, fussing at him. We don't like the way you talk to us. Because he says here that I may not seem as if I would terrify you with letters. You think I'm terrifying because I'm straight and to the point. I don't have time to fool around with every young person that comes in here and they got 40,000 dozen ideas that are wrong. I'll just say, you can't do that. Stop that. Not I'll talk to you about it. For his letters, say they, this is what they're saying about Paul. His letters, say they, are weighty and powerful, but his bodily presence is weak and his speech is contemptible. We have nothing but contempt for Paul. He's too hard on us. Let such an one think this, that such as we are in the word by letters, when we are absent, Such will we be also indeed when we are present. Wait till I get there. You're really not going to like me. For we dare not make ourselves of the number that compare ourselves with some that commend themselves. We're not going to compare ourselves with people that are bragging about their own work in the ministry, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise. You get over here in a clique and you say, the preacher this and the preacher that, and he don't need to be doing that. You'll end up gone, and we'll end up staying here. And you go out there and start your own little group that lasts 2 months. You get mad at each other and you split up. We've had that happen dozens of times. But we will not boast of things without our measure, but according to the measure of the rule which God hath distributed to us. That word rule is the word canon. Canon, this is the canon. Canon comes from the word cane. They would cut down a cane pole, treat it in some kind of solution till it becomes straight, and they would use it to measure things with. He said, our measure is this canon of Scripture. It's not your opinions. And then he says, for we stretch not ourselves beyond our measure. We're not trying to go beyond anything but the Word of God. As though we reach not unto you, for we are come as far to you also in preaching the gospel of Christ, not boasting of things that have no measure to them. That is, of other men's labors. I'm not going to measure what we're doing by what somebody's got down the street. They've got a great big building and they're preaching lies in it. I'm not going to measure myself by them. But having hope, when your faith is increased, when your faith is increased, oxano, A-U-X-A-N-O, when it grows, here's what will happen. Something will happen in your life. This outer man will keep dying off till you have less of that. And the older you get, and the more fire you go through, and trials you go through, you'll be less quick to judge other people. You will preach the word harder, but you won't be so judgmental. But you will judge righteous judgment. You're not going to let people off the hook because you're going to be partial to them. Your faith will increase that we shall be enlarged. Megaluno. You'll come to a place when your faith increases that you quit fighting everybody. You won't let everybody off the hook. You just lay down the law and say, you can't do that here. If you're a leader, if you're the right kind of leader, your faith will be enlarged you according to our rule abundantly. And here's how your faith will be enlarged: to preach the gospel in regions beyond you, and not to boast in another man's canon, another man's line, another man's preaching of things made ready to our hand. Now look over here in 2 Thessalonians. Faith must increase. That's growing spiritually, isn't it? Now, if we're going to talk about faith, what is it that saves us? By grace you're saved through faith. But it's not a faith that just sits still. It's a faith that grows. Like I said, it's like the longer you live, it starts off small and it gets larger and larger. Faith. 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 And you get stronger and stronger spiritually, and this outer man, the outer man gets weaker and weaker, and you're actually weak in the flesh, but you rely more on God the more your faith grows. But here's what has to grow. This is, people don't want, I had one guy on the internet said, that's the most evil, wicked doctrine that you've ever preached, is faith has to increase. You're an idiot. If your faith doesn't increase, you don't know God. You better get on your face and cry out to God, oh God, teach me something. This man says that when you get saved, you get all the faith you need that you'll ever have. If you get saved when you're 7, you'll never need to be stronger than when you're 7 spiritually. It's crazy. If your faith doesn't grow, you don't have any. And it has to grow quite large from the time it's little faith till it's grown faith. Here's what I want to explain to you, and I'm going to go back to faith growing. When I say faith worketh by love, we've already discovered that faith is death to self. We've discovered that if I have faith in you, that means I don't have faith in me to make a decision on what needs to be done in that situation. If I have some carpentry work that needs to be done for Grace and Truth Ministries, I'm not going to try to do it. I'm not a carpenter. What I'm going to do is I'm going to call Phil. I'm going to call one of our carpenters because I can't do it. I'm going to have faith that they can do what I need done. We've got several guys that's been carpenters here. Phil and Fred. Fred is a super carpenter. I'm certainly not going to rely upon me. I'm going to say, I want to depend on you. I'm not a mechanic. If I need a car worked on, Phil works on cars. We got other people. But if it's something real difficult, I'm going to take it to a top flight mechanic or a dealer. I don't know anything about it. So why would I do it? I'd be foolish for doing it. And that's what faith is. It relies, it dies to self concerning this situation. So here's what, when faith works, self is dying. We've already discovered what faith is. It works. We read out of John, out of James, the second chapter last week, wilt thou know, vain man, that faith without works is a dead faith and it's good for nothing? Faith has to work. If it works, it grows. Now, let me give you, I was going to give you something, I forgot what it was. Now, let's go over here. Huh? I can't hear you. 2 Thessalonians. I need to give you this too. Yeah, let me give you 2 Thessalonians, the first chapter. First chapter, verse 4. We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren. Now, the brethren are the people there at Thessalonica. That's right up here next to Philippi. Right there. Or Thessalonice, or Thessalonica, however you want to pronounce it. Now, he says, we're about to thank God always for you, brethren. None of these books were written to vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. They're all written to the brethren. How did these books come about? Paul would leave on his first missionary journey, and he'd go up to up here to Syria, leave over here, go to Cyprus, come up here, hit Perga, go to Antioch, come over to Iconium, down to Lystra, and then Derbe. And then he'd come back home. That would be his first missionary journey. Then he'd take off and come up here on his second missionary journey and come over to Lystra, work his way over here, come over through Ephesus, and work over here to Philippi and Thessalonica. And then end up coming down here. And as he would go to another place, he would write back, he would write the scriptures. And he'd be writing a letter to Philadelphia when he's over here in Greece. He'd be writing to the Philadelphians. He'd be writing to Colossia, and that's what the book of Colossians is about. After he'd come through here and had some experiences with them, he would write back, and he would hear certain things that's going on. He'd do the same thing with Ephesus, the same thing with Philippi, the same thing with Corinth. He had heard that Corinth was too lazy to support their church, so he writes up here to Philippi, and these are some of the most unselfish people in the Bible, and they send money down here to Corinth so that the apostles can pick it up and carry it over here to Israel, because Israel's under a lot of fire from Rome, because they're always trying to get free from Rome, and they had a lot of insurrection over there. So they would send this money for food over there, and the 8th and 9th chapters of 2 Corinthians is about that. When the Bible says God loves a cheerful giver, that's not about the tithe at all. God loves a cheerful giver is in the benevolent chapters, 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. Those two chapters are about a gathering for money for the people. This is after Jesus is dead. By 70 AD, the Roman armies are coming in there. Titus, the Roman general, his father is the Caesar at Rome, and then he's sending Titus down here to conquer Israel, because Israel has been upset since they've been ruled by Rome with an iron hand, and Israel was always in a insurrection situation where they're trying to overthrow Rome, and Rome's always at war with them. That's why in 70 AD, Titus brings the army down there, not the entire army, they would have wiped them out, and they conquer Israel, and they level the city of Israel in 70 AD. It was a political fight constantly. So, where was I? Faith works by agape. So what we got to do is find out everything that agape does and everything that agape is, everything that it produces. And when you get into what it produces, you get off in this pinwheel kind of situation. You know, a pinwheel is like this. And the more you study something, the more you learn, this branch is off, this branch is off. So whenever we're studying faith, let me show you what you got to do. If you're going to study a word and what it does and what it is, you need this book, or you need a program on your computer where you can look up all these words. Now, if I'm going to study agape. Now, you're going to hear people say agape, and you're going to hear them say agapao. I don't care how you pronounce it. The reason I pronounce it agape is because it looks like that. Besides that, you're never going to be able to pronounce the Greek words right. We don't even know how they were pronounced fully. We don't know. You don't know how the Hebrew words were pronounced. I pronounce them the way they look on the paper. I'll say Athaliah, the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel. Sometimes I'll say Athaliah. It was probably pronounced Athaliah, but it looks like Athaliah, so we'll just keep pronouncing it like that. If you're pronouncing Greek words, usually they Hebrew words, they've got that in the middle of the word. Sounds like German, you know, or something. They've got the guttural sounds in there. We're never going to get those pronounced right. I'm not concerned about whether you pronounce them right. I want you to know what they mean and what it led to. Let me give you something here. What I do, this is a word study concordance. When you look up a word, you look it up in here. What you do is you look up the number in your Strong's Exhaustive Concordance. Then you go in here, look up the number. It will give you every time that word is mentioned in the Bible. It'll give you the noun form. It'll give you the verb form. Right here. Let me give you this. And you'll learn the Bible more. When you look up love, agape, it'll be number 25. And it'll be number 26. Agapao, or agapao, however you want to pronounce it, will be number 25. And this is every time. Agapao is the verb form. What's the difference between a noun and a verb? A noun is a person, place, or thing. A verb shows action unless it is a being verb, an intransitive verb. Intransitive, a transient is someone who moves around all the time. We got transients down in Nashville. They move from one corner to the other begging. That's a transient, or somebody who moves to Hendersonville, then moves to Florida, and then moves to Colorado. That's a transient. Intransitive means no movement. That's a being verb. Being verb. Be, is, am, are, was, were, being, been, so forth. Those are being verbs. A transitive verb is an action verb because a transient moves around. Transitive, S-I-T-I-V-E. A transitive verb is what we would call an action verb. Well, like I said a while ago, faith is a noun. It is a thing. The action of faith works by agape, faith works. Whether anybody says faith works or not, well, they'll say, we're saved by grace through faith, and that not of yourselves is the gift of God, not of works. Faith comes into your heart not by anything you work to do. It's the gift of God. It's by grace. Grace, charis, means unmerited favor. You didn't do anything to get faith put in your heart. Nothing. It just appears there one day for God's gracious reasons. So He can birth us by His will and then cause us to work. Not to be saved, but because we are being saved, and He is our Father, and it's His will that we work. We are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. We were created to do good works. Agathos, which God hath before ordained, before the world began, He before ordained pro. E-T-O-I-M-A-Z-O. Proetoimazo means to fit up in advance. God has fitted His elect family to good agathos beneficial works. Same word as Romans 8 and 28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, that's agape, to them that walk after the commandments of God because God wrote them in their heart. And you will do it, and I will do it. It's amazing that I'm preaching this message here because I wouldn't have preached this when I was 30. No, that's salvation by works. We have to work, but not works of self-righteousness. Not works of ritual, but God working in you to will and to do of His good pleasure in Philippians 2:13. Now, this is every time the word agape, agapao, the verb form of love is mentioned 100 right there, 142 times in the New Testament. It comes all the way down through here. And agape It's mentioned 116 times in the New Testament. But when you get into agape, you're going to have to watch how it connects constantly with faith. So faith is dying. And when you're dying, the outer man is dying off. The inner man is growing. That's a living faith. You're dying more and more to the flesh. You will not continue with some of the sin that you have today in the future. If you are a true believer, you'll come to a place you say, I've got to stop this. So, now where was I? So if I want to study agape, I make a printout off of a copy machine. I go through here and I'll mark a bunch of these and I'll say, let me see here. Men love darkness rather than light. Agapao. They love darkness. That's why. Because their deeds are evil and that's why they won't follow God. Their agape is towards walking in the commandments of something else besides God. You can have an evil agape. The Bible says if you only love those that love you, and those are the words agape, what do you more than the Pharisees? He's saying the Pharisees have an agape. I preached a message on evil agape one time. I preached on it a couple times. And I brought out that the mob, the mafia, they have an agape. If you don't do what they say, and they burn that paper in your hand, they say, you will burn if you don't follow our commandments. And that's an evil agape. And you have to follow the... If you run with the world, if you run with a bunch of rock stars and rock singers, where I've been, Dave's been, you got to walk in their commandments or you're out. The more you fit in with them, the more drugs you'll take with them. They know that you're a part of them and you're not going to go over and tell somebody on them. They're not going to expose them. There's evil agape. So it's walking in the commandments of whatever you're following. It's walking in a law. Now let me read here in 2 Thessalonians. We're bound to thank God for you, brethren, as it is meet or as it is worthy, because that your faith groweth exceedingly. He said, you're getting strong over there at Thessalonica. And the charity, the agape, see, faith is growing here at Thessalonica because the agape of every one of you all toward each other aboundeth. It's multiplying. It's increasing. Your charity is increasing, which is the word agape. Therefore, your faith is growing exceedingly. Remember the word there in the 10th chapter of 2 Corinthians? He said, when your faith begins to grow, he said, then you'll lift me up instead of putting me down. Well, that's what's going on right here. This word here is the word hoopoxano. Over there in 2 Corinthians 10, the word is oxano, increase, A-U-X-A-N-O. That's the word increase. It means to increase. It means to multiply. When your faith increases, you say, Jim, you seem to have a lot together. That's because I'm old and white, and I've been a believer for 70 years. Gone through enough fire to convert everybody. If you've got to plot it in the right place. If I say this, I speak foolishly. I've got a lot together spiritually. But if you don't have it 77, you're very foolish. And you will recognize when that's happening. Because if you don't recognize when it's happening, you're going to say, what do these words of the Bible mean? Here I am 90 years old, I still can't figure them out. You will figure them out. When you change, you'll know you're changing. When you're trying to get rid of sin out of your life, you'll know it's happening because you're making an all-out effort because God has convicted your heart after so much fire and you're tired of fighting God. You'll wake up that your fight is with God, it's not with the world. That's who we fight. When we're fighting that inner man and that outer man, which direction is our efforts going towards? Is it going out here in the world? And you got a new birth in you? No. You're fighting the inner man. He's fighting you, and he's God, and he's going to win. And if this inner man is not fighting you, you see, if you don't have an inner man, there's nobody fighting. He's fighting this desire to have your way, and faith has to increase. And he says, your faith is growing exceedingly, and your charity is abounding. Charity is agape. These two go together, agape. But let me show you some other things. Now, what we're going to have to do, go over here to 2 Peter. If your faith is going to grow, here's what has to happen. Not if your faith's going to grow. If you're a believer, your faith will grow. You say, Jim, I just can't get strong. Well, you hadn't been at it long enough. If God will beat you up real bad, you'll surrender. What you're surrendering to is the inner man. You're not surrendering to the world. Everybody's got the wrong idea. They say, well, I'm humble. I'm out here humbling myself to all the world. You're not supposed to humble to the world. You're supposed to humble to the inner man. Christ in you, his commandments, his instructions. You know when you do wrong. You like to pretend you don't. Well, Jim, is this wrong? Well, why are you asking me? That's the whole point. Is it wrong to drink? Why would you ask me that kind of question? Was it wrong to cuss? I'm not going to answer that. You're not even asking it. You're looking for a way out. You can't get a way out of responsibility and accountability and the likeness of Jesus. You're predestined to conform to that. That comes with a whole world of fire. You might as well give up now, but you can't. You might say, I surrender to the Lord. You'll wish you had of in another 30 years, but you. And you'll also say, but I wanted to surrender, but I couldn't. I was too untried. After God will try you so long, you'll find out. Now look here. 2 Peter. Now, what are we going to do with this when it comes to growing? 2 Peter 1. And when I'm studying, this is the way I'm thinking. 2 Peter 1. All right. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to them, now here is, listen who he's writing to them that have obtained like precious faith. Now he's going to tell them their faith has to grow. It's amazing, I just saw something right now. It's amazing what I just saw. Start off, look here. I just saw this. Now, faith works by agape, doesn't it? So we start this whole conversation with those who have obtained like precious faith. He's not writing to vessels of wrath fitted to destruction. These instructions are only for people who have already obtained faith. But that was a gift of God. We got to go by other doctrines in the Bible. That's a gift of God, isn't it? You have to watch what happens with these things. He's only talking to believers, isn't he? Right? Those that obtain like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Now, this faith came through the righteousness of God. You didn't have any in you. He just put the faith in you. But he's going to make it go to work. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God. Now, where are we going to get his knowledge? Out of this book. But you can't fake knowledge. You can hear guys try to fake it. You can listen to Hank Hanegraaff, and he'll use a $20 word about every two sentences, and he loses you. You don't have any idea where he went to, because he went off in space with some words. Did anybody ever listen to him?
They just agree with him and thank him, and then send the conversation.
Yeah, it's funny how they end the conversation, isn't it? Now, you got that? Yeah. You want to just... And listen to R.C. Sproul, and he's got two $20 words every sentence. You're going, what in the world is he talking about? I would tell those guys if I saw them, don't you know you're confusing little sheep? You have no business giving somebody a word, a big word, that they don't know what it is. If I give somebody a big Greek word, I'm going to tell you exactly what it is.
Then he says, buy his book.
Huh?
Yeah.
I got a book. Now, where were we? Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and Jesus Christ, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things. He's not given us all money. It's all things that are necessary to grow in faith and truth. All things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these promises ye might be partakers of the divine nature. That's the same thing as being conformed to the likeness of Jesus, isn't it? Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, and besides these things, giving all diligence, add to your faith. Now, this is not an invitation. Add is not an invitation. It's not even the word add. It's the word epi. C-H-O-R-E-G-E-O. Add this to your faith so your faith can grow. But it'll grow by agape, by walking in the commandments of God. Add is the word epikoregeo. It comes from epi. Anytime you see that prefix on the front of a word, it means over, on top of, to superimpose or cover with. It's one of the words in Acts 2:38 for be baptized in the name. Peter commanded to be baptized in the name of Jesus. That word means to cover, in that case, means to cover with God's name. His onoma means authority. It can't mean water, means cover with. This word here means to cover your life with the C-H-O-R-E-G-E-O. Choreography, G-R-A-P-H-Y. Choregeo comes from chorus and ago. It means a chorus leader or a dance leader. That's what a choreographer is. And this is an imperative command. It's an imperative mood, which is a command. It's just as much of a command as when God said, let there be light, and there will be light. And there will be this circular dance. The Jews had a circular dance. They called it a sacred dance. I've got a book by a Jewish writer, brilliant man. The title of the book is The Sacred Dance. They would dance around. They would sing Hava Nagila at their festivals. It's a circular dance. He said, here's your circular dance. Let me give it to you. Got 7 points in it. Now, this is what we have to add to our faith. And when we add to our faith is going to work by these points here. And then he says, add to your faith virtue. Oh, well, is it just a word, virtue? Does it mean anything? Well, yeah, it does. Virtue means, it's the word arete. It means maturity. Boy, are we on a line here. I may have to come back to next week and address that because there's another word that means maturity. And that is the word. Does anybody remember it?
Teleos.
Huh?
Teleos.
Yeah, teleos. And there's many forms of this. Teleos. Teleotes. Telos. Teleo. And it means to be mature or grown. And when the Lord says in the 6th chapter of Matthew, very last verse, be ye therefore perfect. Be perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. It doesn't mean to be without sin. It means to be teleos, be mature, grow up. But that takes time because your faith has to increase and you have to grow, and that is very slow. It's a slow process. I've gone through so many hurts in my life, so many tears. I've cried a million tears. I've gone through hard, hard times. I've been close to death a dozen times. I mean, just, I can't even begin to tell everybody all the tears and the hurts I've been through. When I hear you talking about your hurts, I say, mine don't matter. And they don't matter to me anymore because it's been a long journey through them. So when we, I'll probably come back next week and go through. I'm going to show you what we have to go through. I need to go into this word, teleos. I've got a paper that I've got all of them, all these words down. When the Bible, it means to be a man. So I've got to go into, I got to go into these words because this is a requirement when he says add to your faith. This is your dance right here. And you will dance it. You say, but I don't want to do that. I don't want to study the Bible that much. And I don't want to add knowledge and it takes all this time. Let me tell you, you got something I didn't have when I was young. You've got a teacher, a good teacher. You say, is that a boast? That's boasting in Christ. Only because he caused me to buckle down and make myself dig for years. You got somebody that will teach you. You can get more than an education listening to our DVDs. You'll hear things you've never heard before. You'll hear why baptism is not water. You'll hear something about biblical chemistry, biblical algebra, biblical biology. We'll even talk about erythrocytes and leukocytes. Are you interested in learning that? We'll talk about so many things, some chemistry. I did a series on spiritual DNA, and I got my information out of a chemistry book that a doctor gave to me in Nashville. There is much to learn if you want to learn. If you don't want to learn, stay dumb and not grow. Growth is the only thing that'll get you through this. So when he's saying add these things, here's what I'm going to have to do to really get the full essence of it. I'm going to have to take virtue and couple it with perfect, which is the word mature, because they both mean to grow up and be a man. Perfect. I'm going to have to go to all the places it's used, the things that it affects, So when he's commanding us to add to our faith, faith is growing, it's increasing, and it's going to work by this agape. But I noticed something. I noticed it when I started reading this chapter. I've never seen it before. Let's read on down here. And to knowledge temperance, the word temperance, kratia, E-G-K-R-E-T-E-I. It means self within control. It means control within you. Control how? My anger? Yeah. Your desires? Yes. Your lust? Yes. Everything you can think of that this outer man wants to do that you know the inner man is forbidding, and it takes a lifetime to learn to stop those things. First of all, you get so old you don't feel like doing what you used to feel like doing when you were young. And that helps, but it'll be the conviction in your heart and your mind that makes you pull away from it. Say, I can't do that anymore. What you'll do is you'll get up to about 50, and you'll see, if you go through enough fire, 50 or 60, and you'll see that nothing you ever tried to fix got fixed. You'll find every person you ever got angry at, it didn't work. Every hunger you had was never fulfilled. You actually find that, don't you find that out? It never has worked, has it? Never will work. The only thing works is in Christ. That's all. What has really made me content in life is faith. See, young people think, but I can't be happy with just faith in agape. You can't be happy with what you got. I promise you that. God, you, and you cannot even understand faith working by love until he makes you surrender that desire for the flesh. And you won't get rid of all of it, but you'll get rid of a bunch of it after so many years. And I'm so thankful for this. So every one of these things here, they all are included. Temperance, self-control, patience, hupomone. You know where you're going to get that? The trying of your faith is much more precious than gold that perisheth, though it be tried by fire. You got to have fire. You got to be tried. You got to go through trials. Think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. You think this is strange when you go through hard times? I told a guy yesterday morning, I said, the reason you're going through this, if you are a believer, is because God wants you to. He said, that's to get rid of my girlfriend that won't stay with me. I said, yes. I said, you don't need to be living together anyway. And he said, in other words, this is for my good. I said, yes, it is. Everything you go through, if God can give you a harder time than he's given you, you'll mature. And he will, guess what? You think your trials are over with? You really made a mistake there. If I'd have thought my trials was over, when I was 45, when I thought I was dying, I'd have just thrown my hands in the air, and I was ready to. But it's not. It's the great philosopher, Yogi Berra, made the great statement. It's not over till it's over. And you can believe the fire is not done in your... Well, I've cried all these tears. Well, just wait till you get older. You go back and count them, and you can't count them. Now, what was that? Let's keep on reading. And he says, to patience, godliness. Have you ever thought about living godly? I'll tell you what, living godly, Mr. Strong says, he said it's the gospel. and its scheme. It's the whole picture of the gospel, he says. Well, the gospel is a resurrection. It means to come to life after dying. Add to your faith daily dying. Now, look here. And to patience, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness. And that's the word philos, adelphos, Philadelphia. We call Philadelphia the city of brotherly love, but I don't think it is. Philos, adelphos. Philadelphia is the word. Comes from philos, an affection for the brethren. Adelphos is the word brother. Brother. But you're not supposed to have affection for your brother unless he's walking in God's commandments, are you? Now look, I want you to notice something. I just noticed when I started reading this. And brotherly kindness, agape. What did we start with in verse 1? To them that obtained like precious faith. And it works you all the way through to agape. Faith works by love, by agape. Now that's amazing, isn't it? God even puts that in the scripture. Now I got to give you something. How much time do I have?
Seven.
I got to come back and go through these words in order for you to see how self dies off and how your faith increases and you get stronger. Anybody who don't believe in an increasing faith, they are heathens. They're very evil and wicked. You have to increase. You can't stand still. God won't allow that. You know, the apostle said, Lord, increase our faith. This guy said, well, they didn't have any faith. You can't increase your bank account unless you got some money in it. They had little faith. You just kept telling them that. But I like what Spurgeon said. Little faith saves. If you got a little faith, you die at 20 years old, but you do have faith. You just didn't live long enough for your faith to increase. And that's because that's the will of God. Now look over here in Galatians. Look over here in Galatians. I want you to notice some of these words though. Go here into Galatians. I can't leave those words hanging. I've really got to go back. And on each one of those words, I got to put all these little pointers to another word. And that's going to take us to all these other words. And what this word does, and this one, this word is a result of this word. And you take every one of these words. But let me show you something here in Galatians, the fifth chapter. Galatians 5. All right. Oh, by the way, there's only one faith. Besides all this, give all diligence. Add to your one faith. If it becomes a part of faith, it's going to be all one, isn't it? Look here in Galatians 5. And he talks about the works of the flesh down here starting in verse 19. I'm not going to go through that. But look here in verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is. The word fruit is the word harpos. It means to reach out and seize. You seize or you pick fruit. But the word harpos, the fruit of the Spirit, is a singular being verb. That means fruit. By the way, fruit is feminine gender. It's harpos, and it is singular. So all these fruit, when you have one of them, You have all of them, but they're not all as strong as they will be later. It's like having a cluster of grapes. But I want you to notice something here. The fruit of the Spirit is agape. Therefore, when you have agape, you're not going to have all walking all of God's commandments when you're young. You learn to walk in them more, and you have all of these, you have all of these imperative moods, and you may not know what each one of those words are, but it'll be in your heart. You'll know when you're doing wrong. That's why people call me and ask me, is it wrong to live with your boyfriend? I say, I'm not going to answer that. You need to get out of there. I'm that blunt, that quick. I said, why do you, one guy called me and said, he said, my girlfriend won't listen to me. I said, are you living with her? He said, yes. I said, why do you expect her to? You're living in sin. He said, yeah, I know it. I said, get married to her. I've had several of them got married.
So this would this be equal to a part of is the whole?
That's right. It's not only a part as a whole. The fruit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. Faith, well, you add to your faith, and faith is one part of this. And there's one faith, so whenever you add to this, you're adding the same thing. When you have these things, you're having the same thing that 2 Peter says with the one faith. Can you see that? You can just line all these up and quote all of these and quote all there in 2 Peter. Now, let me give you one other thing, and I'll come back. I got to come back and talk about this. Every bit of this is going to come into our lives slowly. Look over here in 1 Corinthians 13, and I'll come back to this. I have to. I don't have time to go into it. So if you can remember Galatians 5:22 and 2 Peter 1 and 5, and over here in the 13th chapter, here's the things that faith does. Faith is because it works by agape. And he says, I'm just going to skip down here and come back and look at the first part next week. Charity suffereth long, there in verse 4. Charity is the word agape. Well, faith, when it's working, it's putting up with a lot. Long-suffering means patient. Long-suffering, macro, T-H-U-M-I-A. Macros means long. Thumos means to breathe hard. Epithumos is the word lust. Macrothumos is putting up with a lot. Before you lose it, you'll really put up with a lot. I put up with a lot from a lot of people. I've had people curse me, accuse me of things that's not true, say the most outrageous things about me. Had one guy write a letter and said about 25 lies in the letter. And he actually believes he's right. And he wasn't. And I didn't get mad. I'm not going to get mad. I've learned to be long-suffering with people. Long-suffering. I need to go through this. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Not is nice, it's kind. I've run out of time. But you can go down through here and see what charity or agape does. When faith works by agape, it's going to go through all of these things. You say, that sounds like an awful lot of work. It is. It's God working on you over the years. You know what happens? You just get tired of fighting. Your old self says, I'm tired. I'm quitting. If you're still mad at me and angry at me, you got the problem because I don't. I just refuse to fuss because I'm too old for it. I guarantee you can't get Milton to fight you. He's 95. When you get to be that old, you don't want to fight no more. Now, he'll cry. Sheriff Sheldon goes away, and he don't come back soon. He'll cry, won't he? He sure will. He's very tender now. I love you, Milton. So when you go all the way through here, it's going to take a long time to go through all of this character of agape and faith. Faith works. People say it don't work. They're saying they don't have to increase in faith. They don't have to get strong spiritually. They're already strong. I got one guy gets on the internet and does everything but cuss me. He don't know that's not increasing faith. I have some people call and cuss. They'll cuss, use real filthy language for a while, and then start quoting Bible for a while. And one time I asked a guy, "Would you learn that in Sunday school?" I'm not going to get mad at them. I just think they're crazy. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for truth and for your word. Teach us that these things that are happening to us are for our good. They're going to wear us out till we get tired of fighting you. And we think we're fighting the world, and that's what I used to think. And now I know when these things happen, that's just you. Thank you for that. You told us in everything, give thanks. Even for the bad stuff, because that's what turns us around. Thank you. Lead us to elect, fight our battles in Christ's name. Amen. Y'all realize how much details there are to the scripture, how you have to go into all this to actually get the whole picture. Can y'all see that? Get the big picture. It's things you'll never get to. You're not going to get to all this. I'm not going to get to all of it. All I'm doing is teach you how to reach out in scripture and see things, and you're just going, it's like a tidal wave your whole life of learning. And you'll never learn it all. But the hard thing to learn is when you're young is to give up self. Because self is enjoyable when you're young in the flesh. And if you live long enough, you don't want to go to the fair. You don't want to get on a boat. You don't want to ski. You don't want to... Do you? You don't want to do it. Somebody says, let's go to the fair. I say, no, you go to the fair. No. You hadn't got there yet. No, I only go to the fair when Mary makes me go to the exhibits. That's the only way I'll go. Get me down on the, what do you call it, the fairway, the...
Midway.
Huh? Midway. Get me on the midway, you'd have to tie rope around my neck and get a tractor at the other end and start dragging me. I'll be fighting all the way. And I used to live, when I was 15, I lived a block from the fair, and I was thrilled when it come to town. Now I'd be griping with all the cars parking all around my house. But you do get tired when you get older, don't you? You don't want to play.
Yeah. But Mike's on the